Good morning. Welcome to Legana Christian Church. My name's Kate. You've stumbled into our 10 a.m. worship service on a Sunday morning. We worship here in Legana in Tasmania, but we don't know where you are. It could be anywhere. As you come into church this morning, we want you to fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And I've got a quote for you this morning related to Jesus and who he is. This quote is by Charles Colson. He's a former White House counsel and he was the founder of Prison Fellowship. He wrote a book called Born Again, 1972, which was the account of his conversion during the Watergate investigation. So dark days in American politics there. He says this, "Once faced with the staggering proposition that he is God, I was cornered. All avenues of retreat blocked. No falling back to that comfortable middle ground about Jesus being a great moral teacher. For what he taught includes the assertion that he is indeed God. And if he's not, that one statement alone would have to qualify as the most monstrous lie of all time, stripping him at once of any possible moral platform." Well, here at Legana Christian Church, we recognise Jesus as God's Son, his one and only begotten Son, and he is part of the Trinity, Father, Son and Holy Spirit. And it is that God that we worship this morning, and we gather together in Jesus' name. So you're welcome to join us as we praise and worship him this morning. God bless you. See you later in the service.
Good morning, welcome to church. If you'd like to please stand, we're going to worship our God. Welcome to those who are listening from home. I hope that you can join us this morning in worshiping God and hearing his word this morning. We pray that God will bless you this morning. If you'd join me with prayer, we'll do that now. Dear Lord God, thank you for this morning that we can glorify you and give you the praise that you deserve and honour you. We thank you for your sacrifice and for your love for us, Lord, and we just pray that we can use this time to glorify you in return. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Sing a thousand generations.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb.
Sing, your name is the highest.
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and divisions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, lifted high, holy, stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
Sing that again.
Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. Your name stands above him all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
Hear your people,
hear your people.
Sing our new song, Both Sides. We sing about our King rising from the grave,
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ, who calls the dead to life, call me from my guilty tomb. No stone, no grave can hold back your power. No lie, no chain can hold down your love. And every knee will bow, and everyone will know you're King of both sides of the stone.
Savior King.
Savior King, who's on with arms stretched wide, the solace of that crimson flood.
With his final breath,
with his final breath, the Savior died. Oh, oh, it is finished. Oh, it is done.
No stone,
no stone, no grave can hold.
Sing that Friday was no funeral.
That Friday was no funeral. Our Sunday Savior's alive. He holds the keys in resurrection hands. Let all God's people rise with him. No storm could stop his name. He overcomes with resurrection hands.
That Friday.
That Friday was no funeral. Our Sunday Savior's alive. He overcomes with resurrection hands. Let all God's people rise with him. No stone could stop his name. He overcomes with resurrection hands. Oh.
sing He's alive.
My name is Rika, and I'll be leading us in the prayer for the state of the nation. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the privilege of coming together as your people to worship you, to pray, and to hear your word preached. As we think of our state and nation, we have so much to be thankful for. The freedom to gather together as churches, for the community organisations that help people who are struggling, and the opportunities that we have to gain employment to support our families. But we also know that there are always many concerns that we need to continually lift up in prayer to you. We think of the elections that have just taken place in Tasmania. We pray for each person who has now been elected, that they would be in our prayers as they begin the process of forming a well-functioning government. We know that you are the one who is Lord of all. We ask that your hand would be guiding our state and federal governments in their decision-making. Even if it means speaking to individuals through dreams and visions, or calling us your followers to speak up when there are injustices or things that need attention. We pray your blessing on the Australian Christian Lobby to work in Parliament for our Christian values. We pray for the Christian leaders in all spheres of our society to be courageous. May each leader surrender to you, no matter what the cost. I pray for all believers in our state and nation to be uncompromising. Put a hunger and thirst in our hearts to do what is right. Make us a light to this generation to show others that we serve a God who is alive. For those in our communities who don't know you, may they be saved. For those who have walked away from their faith through various reasons, may they return to you, knowing that you are a God full of grace and mercy. I pray for our children and our youth. Keep them safe from the many agendas in our society that pull them away from the truth. May they find shelter in you. May they be strong in their faith so that they can walk against this peer pressure. For those who are sick, we ask that you heal them. Be with those who are facing their last days, and be with their families. Give them the comfort and peace to face these difficult times, knowing that there is a hope for now and also for an eternity. Revive our nation. May we see an outpouring of your Holy Spirit. We need you, God. Nothing in this life matters when we compare it to your glory. May we see it with the eyes of eternity. May we be faithful and obedient to your word. As we head into this coming week, Lord, I pray we would look to you for everything. I pray that every anxious thought and every fear be dissolved as we put our hope and our trust in you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please, Sam, we'll continue to worship. Sing, great is thy faithfulness.
And great is thy faithfulness.
Summer and winter.
Ten thousand please.
Great is. you, church.
Good morning and welcome to church again. My name's Tom, definitely the oldest Tom in the building this morning. And we're going to enter into a time of communion together. So if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Saviour, please join with us as we partake of the communion emblems this morning. And if you did forget to, on the way through, to pick up your emblems, now is a good time to go and make amends for that little discretion. And I just want to share this with you this morning, this little Bible. It was handed out as a Sunday school gift in Newtown, Hobart, on the 22nd of October 1865, just 3 years before convict transportation officially ended in Australia. And it was handed down many years later to my dear mother-in-law, and then in recent times to me and Julie. So I guesstimate it's at least 160 years old. Is there anyone here that's 160? Oh, what was that? Someone said half that age. Anyway, I'd like to read from Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 6 and 7 from this little Bible. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. That prophecy was written about 700 years ago before the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. There's also other prophecies in the Bible that tell us that Jesus would be born of a virgin, he would be betrayed for 30 pieces of gold, silver rather, and he would be placed in a rich man's tomb and he would rise 3 days later. And Jesus himself predicted that he himself would be crucified and he would be raised to life on the third day. And so as we take communion this morning, we can be assured that our faith is on solid ground with our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. And we can be reassured and comforted by those prophecies that have come to pass as we partake of the elements this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 tells us, on the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat the wafer together. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink together. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you have sent Jesus, who died once and for all on the cross and rose on the third day victorious. We thank you that we stand on solid ground. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ of solid rock we stand. Amen.
Good morning. Let's a bit special, isn't it? Having a Bible 165 years old. I went to Hungary and where my dad went to university, and it was really, you know, you think back 165 years, what did Australia look like then? And you think, oh, that's a long time ago. But my dad went to this university that we visited, and it said founded in 928. And I just thought, man, that's old. Man, that's old. But we meet now, as many people over millennia have met, to worship Jesus. Coming on a Sunday, on the Sabbath, we put our distractions aside and our sole focus is to come and focus on God and to worship Him. And that's what we do. And around the world right now, people are meeting. And so for some, their day hasn't even started. People are meeting to worship Christ, to do exactly that. Some people, their day hasn't yet started. Some people have big churches. Some people have little churches. Some people are in home churches, but they're still all meeting together. So we can picture all over the world for millennia past, even until now and in the future, people meeting with their sole focus is to worship God. And some people are meeting in fear of death. They're living in different philosophical outlooks like communism or Islam. And for them to meet is they are threatened with death, but they still choose to, because it's so special, because it is the crux of our life is based on Christ, and they are prepared to come out of that safe zone to meet with their brothers and sisters and focus just on Jesus. And we come this morning and we may have fears of coming to bear ourselves, fears of, we may have distractions of the week, we may have distractions of what's for lunch, we may have distractions about what's she wearing, we may have distractions about did they really know that was the colour of the hair dye, you know, whatever it is, we may have distractions, and here we choose to put them aside in the same way that in some countries they may be put to death, they put that distraction aside. So let's pray, and we will pray for our church. This is the time when we do pray for our church and our church needs. So we will pray. And then afterwards, if you will be brave, if you will put your fears aside, the two people here will come around with a microphone. If you have a prayer or you feel God is saying something, then feel free to do that. Father, we come to you, we put our distractions aside and we worship you, and we thank you that we can come to this point where we choose to put all that aside and focus on you. You are our God and we love you. We think we love you with everything that we have, but God, you love us more than we can even understand. You liken us to your bride. You love us. And thank you, God, for that. And we pray right now that just as it was raining last night, you would rain down in here with your Holy Spirit, that, Lord, you would change hearts and lives and minds, and that we would be focused on you, that our worship would be of you. We pray, Lord God, that you would speak to us and through us. We pray our hearts would be yours. And God, a few weeks ago we heard that you yearn for us to come to know you better, to surrender to you more. We heard that we can be dry bones and you want to put flesh on those bones. So God, we surrender ourselves afresh again to you, and we pray, have your way in our lives and in our church. Now, if you have a prayer, please pray. Or if you have a word, please share.
Lord, thank you for your presence here with us. Thank you, Lord, for that picture we had of all the people of God meeting around your throne to worship you in all eternity. And thank you, Lord, that we can look forward to that. But thank you for the opportunity we have today to just come and worship and praise and honour you. Thank you, Jesus.
Someone else?
Lord, we do want to thank you this morning. As we sang that song, Great is Your Faithfulness, Lord. Every day you remind us of your faithfulness. And as Kim just touched on, that rain this morning and the way the state's been, Lord, we just thank you for that. We thank you for the many blessings that you pour out upon our lives. And Lord, my prayer this morning is that each of us let go of those hindrances and those things that might interfere with our relationship with you, that we would humble ourselves. We'd be a people that would just come before you and humble ourselves, seeking your face, Lord, seeking to see your hand move in this place, in this region, that people's lives would be transformed and your name be glorified.
Yes.
Father, have your way in this church. For each person here today, Lord, touch their hearts, yes. Speak into their lives, yes. Speak into their situations, yes. That they might know the power of your Spirit working in them. Lord, give us faith. Give us all faith to trust in you, in Jesus' name. Mm.
Your people, the people that may be parched, the land may be dry in their life, their emotions may be in turmoil. Holy Spirit, I ask that today that you, by your power, would rain down on your church, on the people that love you, the people that have stepped even away from you. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come, that you would comfort, that you would dispense and disperse their worries and anxieties, yes. And that they would know above all things that you are God. You are never out of season. You are always in season. Whether it's summer, autumn, winter, or spring, you are always there. And Father, I ask for this church. I ask, my God, that you would rain afresh on this church, on your body, that as we are facing a new season coming in you, we believe and know that you are in control and that you are a covenant God, that you are there in grace, in mercy, that you will provide leadership, that you will provide shepherd, that you will provide the one that can preach the word of God that the church needs. I thank you, God, for the leadership in Andrew and Kim now. Mm-hmm. God, I ask that you will strengthen, you encourage, you will empower, you will strengthen, you will continue to anoint, Lord. Father, we thank you for our shepherds today, and we are encouraged, God, in your church, your body. And I pray in that encouragement that we would step out afresh and with an anointing in each of our lives to say that Jesus is Lord to those people around us. Make a way, I pray, for the unsaved to come into your church, Lord. Your church, no matter where it may be, I pray for the unsaved to come, that the ground will be fertile in their hearts and that your word will just penetrate and will just draw them to yourself. In your mighty name, amen.
Thank you. If there are people who would like to come and have individual prayer, whether it is a recommitment, a resurrender, a dryness that you want to be filled, God, we pray, have your way in this place. And Lord, and now we invite you also, if you would like to come out, you can, and we will pray for you, whatever your need, as we sing the next song.
If you'd like to stand, please do. We're going to sing What He's Done.
And see, on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that gave me life. Grace flowing from your side, no greater sacrifice.
Sing what he's done.
What he's done. What he's done. All the glory and the honor to my sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done.
Sing for the freedom.
Sing for the freedom He has won. Even death is dead and done. His life has overcome. And speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave.
What he's done.
All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done.
Sing now.
And now, on the throne of majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory. Sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring.
What He's done.
What He's done. What He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done. Oh, what He's done. What He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done.
I praise.
And I praise God for what He's done. Oh, I praise God for what He's done.
Let's sing what He's done.
What He's done, what He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done.
I praise
God for what He's done.
I praise
God for what He's done.
Thank you, church. Please be seated.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Castillo, and I'm going to pray for missions and missionaries. Father God, You sent Your Son Jesus to restore relationship through the work done on the cross for us. You adopted us into Your family. You call us to have a ministry of reconciliation. You send Your people out to new lands, to new people, to give this message of reconciliation and restoration. We lift up those who are called into missions and to missionaries who are close by and far away. You call us to devote ourselves to prayer, to be watchful, to be thankful, to pray to You for doors to open, that the message of hope may be received and lived out in full. We ask You now to go before Paul and Deb Hilton, who desire to see the peoples of the earth knowing You as their Lord, their God, and knowing that there is no other. As they minister, as they travel, as they train others, as they meet with leaders, As they build relationships between government, community, and the church, may you go before them. May you be at their side. May you give them exactly what is needed, the words on their lips. May they have health, resilience, and hope. For surely there is a future hope, and it shall not be cut off. It shall not disappoint. It shall come to pass. It shall be. We pray, Lord, that you would give all those sent to preach your word boldness and courage, that your word would spread far and wide, and that you would protect them in the most difficult situations. Give their ministry an effectiveness and a momentum. Refresh and restore them. Breathe life on them where they need it. May you give them opportunity to see seed planted and flourishing as it is planted on good soil and produces a great crop for your glory. We pray this in your name, Jesus, in your blood, through your power, Holy Spirit, and in your mercy and faithfulness and love, Father God. Amen.
Good morning, church, and welcome. My name is Marco, and at Legana this Friday and Saturday is a time for Christians to become more engaged in politics for the benefit of our neighbours and culture. There's a church state and conference, so please register. There's a brochure in the foyer. Also, if anyone has any photos or some memorabilia of a relative who was or is in the armed forces, please seek him. And special mention to Dr. Sands and Janet Sands. Happy 57th anniversary. I was going to take a guess, but I won't. Well done. Also, Kids Church, if the kids would like to take Pastor Rika out to Kids Church, that'd be nice. Hold her hand, that'd be wonderful. That's one of the special times I remember going to Kids Church, is remembering the teacher. It was wonderful. Also, I think I'd like to adjust this microphone, but better not touch it. Also, I remember during COVID, one of the most horrible things for me was not shaking people's hands. And from my culture back in Serbia, that was a thing that you done most. And if you failed to shake someone's hand, you were in trouble. So please, you've got 4 minutes to say hello to somebody, introduce yourself. That's 4 minutes now.
Greeting time, take three. We're going to do some Old Testament Bible trivia today to keep your brains in gear while we have this short hiatus in our church service. Old Testament, we're delving into this book of 2 Kings. This question is related to a story that involves Elisha, God's prophet, and someone called Naaman, who had been afflicted with leprosy. The question is a little off to the side of the main part of the story, so I'll give you the question. The curse of Naaman's leprosy was given to whom? So if you're not familiar with the story, you won't be able to answer the question, but if you want a little bit of background on the story, Naaman, who was in charge of an army for the king of Aram, had leprosy, and he went to seek out help from Elisha, based on the word of the servant girl of his wife. And Elisha gave him instructions about how God would cure him from his leprosy. He didn't like the way that Elisha told him he would be cured, so he was going to ignore it. But his servants talked him into it, basically, and he did follow Elisha's instructions, which was to go and cleanse himself in the river. He didn't like the river he was told to go and wash in. But he did, and he was cured. And so he wanted to go back to Elisha, and he wanted to bestow worldly goods, worldly wealth. But Elisha wasn't going to have a bar of it. He was God's servant and he was doing God's work. And he declined the kind offer. But his servant Gehazi, he didn't think this was quite right. He wanted to profit. And so he actually went after Naaman when he was travelling back home. And he did gain talents of gold or something along those lines. But not only that, he lied to Elisha, telling him that he hadn't been anywhere at all. And Elisha, because of the spirit of discernment that God had given him, he knew what Gehazi had done. And so he, Gehazi was stricken with Naaman's leprosy, but not only him, his descendants as well. So we've got another story involving Elisha and Gehazi here for you. This one's also in 2 Kings. The question is, what happened when Gehazi laid Elisha's staff on a dead boy? This is a different story. Elisha knew a Shunammite woman and her husband, and he used to have meals with them. And through God, Elisha had told her that she would have a son because she didn't have a son and her husband was old. Anyway, years later, the son became ill and she came to Elisha. And Elisha told Gehazi to take his staff and to go and lay it on the boy's face. And what happened when Gehazi did that? Absolutely nothing. So even a great man of God like Elisha, nothing happened when he did that. But the story doesn't end there. Even though the boy did die, Elisha followed the woman back to her home and he prayed and interceded on her behalf for the life of her son, and God did restore him to life. There you go. Probably not related to the sermon at all, but sit back and now listen to our teaching.
Please resume your seats. Thank you. We are in a moment going to pray for just a couple of people, and one person who we're going to pray for, him and his wife have never been here. And some of you will know Stuart and Maria Miller, and they are part of The Rock in Capalaba. That's Pastor Sean Wood's church. And Matt, their teenage son, was diagnosed with a brain condition that they tried everything, and this morning Matt died. And so if you'll just join with me, I want to pray for the Rock Church and particularly for Stuart and Maria and their family. So Father, we pray, Lord, that your greatest sympathies, your compassion, your grace would be ministered through Stuart and Maria's church family, and give Pastor Sean Wood the wisdom to be able to navigate this difficult situation for any church, any family. And Father, we thank you that for Stuart and Maria, they have the comfort that we do not grieve like those in the world because we have hope. And Father, we thank you for Matt's all too brief life. And we pray, Father, that his life will leave an eternal legacy in some. Father, I also think of Pastor Carl and Jess Mutzelberg, who are finishing their ministry at Ipswich today, and that, Lord, your peace would be with the church and with them as well in particular. And I pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Welcome to church. And today we are continuing through this year with a theme. And today we're going on a little excursion through the book of Psalms as we explore how the Psalms help us to know God. Part of my motive for this, part of my reasoning for this, is that it's possible to come to church, be religious. It's possible for you to think that if I do Christian things, I am a Christian. It's possible for you to think that if I'm even serving in a church and if you are, thank you. But can I tell you, that's not the thing that makes you right with God or grants you any special access to God. And part of my deep concern, and I hope you'll join me in having this concern, is that we want to reach a culture that thinks Christianity is just one of the many religious options you can pick, like a census option tick box. And it just so isn't. And I hope we'll work together as a church family to encourage people to actually know God. And I want us to be really clear about this, and I want us to really know what that means, what that feels like, and what that looks like, because there will be some people that will lie to people about this. For example, we all want to hear the voice of God, but would you really want to hear the audible voice of God all the time? Would you? It would be scary. It would be. In fact, of those people who have heard the audible voice of God, even in Scripture, for most of them, if you average out the number of times they heard the audible voice of God, it comes down to an average of once in their life. Now, I want you to process that, because even with the great men of God, people like Abraham, you can count about three times it happened over the course of his life. So if this is you now thinking, oh, I've never heard the voice of God, can I tell you, you are above average. You are in a place where if you've been told you have to hear the audible voice of God in order to believe in God, I'm going to suggest to you, you've actually been lied to. Now, I want to be really clear here. There are different ways we can hear things. There's different ways we can perceive communication. One of the things that I do with a couple preparing for them to get married is I try to teach a bloke, because it's really, really difficult to teach blokes about communication. Yeah. And it's difficult because sometimes women say things and they're using words when they're not actually saying what the words represent. When does that happen? Thank you. Sir, pretty much all the time. And the point there is that sometimes communication happens with a look. It can happen with a look of approval. It can happen with a look of disgust. Every man who's been married knows that look. It's the look that you get when you come out about, and you're both about to go somewhere, and your wife looks at you like, see, I haven't said anything, and you all know what she's saying, right? Trevor Chandler, a hero of mine who died 15 or so years ago, he said that you know, Psalm 34 says, God with his eye will guide you. And he said, sometimes with his eye he will wink. The wink of God. And the wink of God could be that he brings someone into your life where he's put his word in them for you. And so the scriptures actually tell us, give heed to the word that was preached. I spoke with a young pastor who's here in Tasmania. His father is a veteran pastor. And this young pastor, late 20s, so still young, like crazy young, has taken on a church that's been around for nearly 100 years. And he said that one of the things that he felt come from the church, the congregation, was, what on earth can you tell us about anything? You're only in your 20s. And they told him that by doing something like this. Didn't say a word. That's all they had to do. You know what that's saying, don't you? You know nothing. And mind you, I've probably done that too. To when I visited a church and I saw someone who was in their late teens who was giving a sermon on the trials of life. Now, for all those teenagers here, yes, life can be terribly hard and you've probably got lots to say about it, but seriously, there can be things that are said that aren't just words, and sometimes, if not most of the time, God speaks into your soul in a way that it doesn't even need words, and you know you've heard from God. And when people say you've heard from God, did you hear him audibly speak to you? No, there are different ways to hear things. I hope you can understand this. So in looking at the Psalms, I want to show you something I hope that maybe you've never seen before. My aim is not to be novel. My aim is not to be original. My aim is not to tell you something you've never heard before so that people can go, wow, I've never heard it put that way before, because there actually is a danger in the preacher that will do that, right? Because there's this saying, I hope you've heard me say it before, it goes something like this: what's new is probably not true. What's true is probably not new. So what I hope you hear today is something that you go, that resonates with me, that sounds right. I hope that's where we land. So this is knowing God through the Psalms, and it is my sincere prayer that everyone will have an experience where they hear from God and they know God, and as a result of this, they come closer to God. So if you're someone who has heard preachers say, on the way to church this morning, God told me that I should whatever, or I remember as a teenager thinking, man, these preachers, boy, they got a hotline to God. And then I heard one preacher say, God told me to do this, and God told me that, and God told me this. And then I went this morning when I got up to go to church, I went to my wardrobe and I said, God, what colour suit should I wear today? And he said, and it shocked him, he said he heard the voice of God say, I'm your father, not your mother, you choose. Now, the fact that he heard God for the first time really was a shock to him, right? So this is what I want you to know about the book of Psalms. If you have a physical Bible, it is about the middle of your Bible. And for those of us that have a Bible, that if we take out the bits that have maps and concordance and all the rest of it, you'll see that's about right. So Psalms is about the middle. This is actually quite an interesting metaphor for how we should have God as the centre of our life. You may not have had any experience with the Bible, and you see this book called Psalms, and you're going, what is a psalm? And there's lots of oddities about English. I don't understand why we do these odd things with English, like have a letter that has no sound, like that P. We put P in front of words all the time, and I don't know why when we don't pronounce that word. So when we die and go to heaven and go to be with the new in the new heaven and new earth, and we all speak Spanish, all these problems will be solved. But for right now, we've got to deal with English and its problems. So when you're citing a psalm, like I'm going to be looking at Psalm 4 in particular this morning. Can I tell you, just do me a favour. If you're going to preach and you're going to preach from a psalm, please do not say turn to Psalms 4. Because I'm going to hear that like, no. It's Psalm 4. Because it's one psalm and it's the book of Psalms. There are all these. A psalm, for those who don't know, is a song. It's what that word means. But it's more than that. And I want to show you this. It's actually something quite interesting. And this is the most interesting thing you will hear me say today. What does the book of Psalms contain? The number one thing it contains, unlike nearly every other book of the Bible, nearly, there are books like Lamentations that do this as well. It contains poetry. Now, I want, for those of you who are not into poetry at all, so it's every man, I'm talking to every man here now, bear with me, just track with me just for a moment, because the book of Psalms is poetry. Now, this is the thing I want you to understand. To write poetry takes thought. I don't know anybody, unless you're really gifted at this, who can just on the spot come out with a long poem and everything makes sense and it rhymes and it's beautiful. Most poetry takes a great deal of thought, a very careful selection of word arrangement, and something that paints a picture. That's what poetry does. It paints a picture in your mind. That's what poetry does. And so all of the Psalms, all of the 150 Psalms in the book of Psalms are written as poetry. In other words, it's meant to do something in your imagination to cause you to see something with the other eyes that you have. Sometimes we can see more clearly when we close these eyes and look where there are other ones. Here's the profound thing about poetry. The Hebrews had a way of saying something that sounded like, if I put it rhythmically, it's like, you see the rhythm? And that's what Hebrew poetry can sound like in Hebrew. So it's not always rhyming, but it's got this rhythm to it. Hebrew poetry will often do this thing called parallelism. So it will say something, then it will pause, then it will say it again with different words, but it's actually saying the same thing. This is what I'm saying. Don't get too worried about the words. Just feel and grab a sense of what God is saying through his word. I'm going to say to you, it takes great amount of thought, great careful selection, a great deal of time to come up with good poetry. And here's what I want you to realize. In Genesis chapter 2, we get the impression that God came down in the cool of the day and walked with Adam. I've said to you, the way I've seen my grandson learn language is he began to make noise. He then began to perceive that noises had meaning. He could... Every boy, young boy, makes noises before, usually about, it takes a girl 6 months prior to the development of a boy to figure out words. But girls are just naturally processed to be able to communicate with words. Boys use sounds like, and that's, seriously, even 45-year-old boys. Sometimes not with their mouth. And so, but So here we have words carefully chosen, really well thought out, has a rhythm to it, and it paints beauty, usually beauty or deep emotion. Adam walked with God in the cool of the day, and just as my grandson would learn to hear the sound of my daughter and son-in-law as they spoke with him, and that he identified objects like food, like eat more, he began to build his vocabulary. Here's the point. Adam's walking with God. He's walking with God and he's hearing God, and over time he began to recognize this is how you talk. And I don't know how long Adam was walking and talking with God. Some scholars estimate it was up to 2 or so years before he created the woman, the first woman. So here's Adam. He's learning how to communicate because he's reflecting God, the one, his literal father. So when we hear Adam for the first time in Genesis chapter 2, for the very first time, the very first thing that comes out of his mouth is poetry. And what does that tell us about God? And what does that tell us about the mind that Adam had without sin? It was careful. His communication was careful. It was selective. It was meaningful. It painted a beautiful picture. The poetry that Adam had when he first saw the woman that God brought to him was, "This is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman." That's actually poetry. And you can tell it's poetry because in your Bible, the publishers will indent it so that you can see, indented line, next line even more indented. It's the publisher is telling you, this is poetry. So the very first method of communication that Adam had in reflecting God was poetry. There is something about being poetic that reflects the heart of God. Now consider this. When the prophets spoke, have a look at the prophets and see how much of what they said was poetry. It's about roughly 80 to 90% of what they said was poetry. This tells us that they are reflecting the heart and the mind of someone who was incredibly thoughtful and wanted to say something, because here's the other benefit of poetry. It's memorable. Memorable? It's memorable. Yeah, don't hurt yourself. Yeah. It's memorable. You remember poetry. Now you might think, oh yeah, that's how they did it back then. We don't use poetry now. Oh yeah. Oh yeah, I see. So how about this? Money, money, money must be. See, you all know poetry, right? We just sing our poetry. We put actual drum beat to the rhythm. We put melody to the sound of the words. And we sing our poetry today. And so the Psalms are designed, they're poetic, they're poetry, but they're poetry that's also to be sung so that it's memorable. Here's the second thing about the Psalms. They are all prayers. Every psalm is a prayer. This is amazing. So this is, sometimes we have no words to express how we're really feeling. And we can read the Psalms and go, that's it. That's how I'm feeling. And I want to encourage you, pray that. Pray that psalm. The Psalms are prayers. And the Psalms beautifully express experiences that people were having. And we're going to read even in Psalm 4, King David, a man whom the Bible says was a man after God's own heart. And David is at a point where we're going to see he's under intense pressure because he's got enemies coming at him. And here we've got David asking God, please listen to me. And what you should hear, but what you should feel, because this is meant to move you emotionally, And imaginatively is, I felt like that. He's expressing my prayer. God, there are some prayers where it's like, you know, God, bless this dinner, amen. Which, if you hear it, you don't hear it, whatever. I'm hungry, I'm going to eat. But there are some prayers, I need you to hear this, God. And David is going to say that. And it might only just be five words, three words in Hebrew, where it's like, wow. So it expresses experiences where people can be incredibly happy. David, in Psalm 51, expresses his guilt and his shame that he's done something wrong that's going to cost him dearly. And then in Psalm 32, is the psalm, it's the order sounds like it's out of kilter a bit here, but it's Psalm 32 is when he receives the forgiveness for that thing. And he says, oh, blessed. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. And we read that and go, well, that's lovely religious talk. Not if you are living with utter shame and condemnation and you have experienced God's forgiveness. That's not a religious thing. That's a deeply satisfying spiritual thing that we all need. See, it expresses experiences. And we have all kinds of experiences summed up in these psalms. And so what we have also is with the prayers, with the poetry, with the experiences that people are actually going through, we have people expressing their heart. We have, as we'll see in a moment, how the book of Psalms is divided into five books collectively called the Book of Psalms. And we have people expressing at times anger toward God. We have people expressing disappointment in God. We have people crying out, where are you? Why didn't you help when I needed your help? And all of these things are in the book of Psalms, which again, for those people who have been told, if you are a real Christian, you'll hear the voice of God, you'll pray and God will speak and you will hear. And there are some people who don't understand that God's dealings with us more often than not is to help us to have the wisdom to make decisions rather than to hear him give us the decision so that we don't have to do any thinking or participation in our own life at all. So the psalmist will express grief, disappointment, tremendous joy, celebration for victory. This is what's going on in the Psalms. But if you're not the type of person that likes to empathize or sympathize with people, the Psalms are going to drive you mad. Because what you're meant to do is to hear what's behind what's being said. And this is one of the things I'm talking about with people, young people, usually young people, preparing to get married, especially for the guys. The girls, they get it. But to explain to a guy that when words are used, you've got to hear what's behind the words. And I'm saying it's the same thing with the psalm. So as a moment, we're just going to look at just eight verses of Psalm 4. And I want you to begin to come with me on an imaginative journey. Begin to imagine, where was David when he wrote this? What was he? Why does he say this? Where's he going? What's going on in his life? And I'm not. You don't have to be precise about it, but you've got to enter into. Here's what is going on here, and it's here because God wants to move us in a direction as well. So, some technical details. I just mentioned before that the 150, they look like chapters or 150 psalms or songs, are organized into five books. And you might think that's just for convenience. No, there's actually something else going on here as well. So the five books, the first two books of Psalms are mainly written by King David. He was the psalmist of Israel, the one who appointed people to sing psalms and make music, and he introduced music into the worship of Israel. If you think back to when God gave Moses the the plans for the tabernacle, which is a tent where it was enclosed in a linen fence, 150 feet that way, whatever that is in English, and 75 feet that way. And here's this tent right back here. There was no music. It was just bring the animal in, sacrifice, take the blood, carry it in there, and do that over and over and over. But David introduced music. We know he was a musician. We know from 1 Samuel 16 that when King Saul was blighted by demons, demonic forces, that they called for a musician to calm the demon activity in King Saul. And they called for David, a young boy. And by him playing music, he was able to do something incredibly spiritual. How many of us realize that music is intrinsically spiritual warfare? And if you don't get that yet, have a look at the last two Psalms of the book, Psalm 149 and Psalm 150. It talks about binding dark forces through music. So this is our singing is an act of spiritual warfare. When we come, we are acting out spiritual warfare by worshiping God. Our worship of God is a profoundly, a deeply, an act of spiritual warfare. So the first two books of the five, mainly written by David. The second last book, which is book four of the Psalms, are the Psalms that originate when Judah, the southern kingdom of Israel, because the northern kingdom, they'd gone 100 years before. They'd gone into idolatry and they were taken by the Assyrians, who eventually the Assyrians would be conquered by the Babylonians. And then the Babylonians would come in under Nebuchadnezzar and take those in Judah over to Babylon. And the Psalms of book four come out of that period where it's like, God, why have you let us down? What a shame. You've brought great shame to us now. All these sorts of Psalms. And you think, gee, this is Debbie Downer sort of stuff. No offences if your name is Downer. But here, and then we have book five. Book five are the Psalms that come when they come back from exile. And so unless you get that, you're going to read through the 150 Psalms and go, just random collection of poetry I don't even understand. But when you recognize it's poetry, that means someone's really thought about this. When you realize it's worship, it's prayer, it's an expression, it's highly emotive, and then you understand the context, kind of changes everything. So if you've got your Bible, and I hope you have, would you please join with me now in Psalm 4? You'll see some of it on the screen. This is something that was written by a scribe who put the Psalms together, and I'm suggesting that probably Ezra or a student of Ezra put the Psalms together, because the Psalms did not exist. The book of Psalms did not exist until Judah came back from exile. And who was it? We read in the book of Ezra. Who was it that taught those people who came back the law? It was Ezra. And what we see in Psalm 1 is a celebration of the law of God. And then we see the other editorial psalm, which is Psalm 119, which has 22 sections in it. And you go, 22? Gee, that's random. No, that's not random either. There's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. One of the letters is the letter, it sounds like S, but with the dot that goes this way, it becomes the sound Sh. So it's sin or shin, but that's counted as one letter with two sounds. But we do that too, don't we? O, O. So we kind of do that, right? So the 22 sections of Psalm 119, each of the sections, Aleph, the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, every line begins with the letter Aleph. Don't tell me that's not clever. Then the next letter is Bet. Guess what? Every line starts with the letter Bet. Gimel, Dalet, and so on, all the way down to Sin Shin. All right. That's crazy clever. That takes way more patience than I've got and Michael Dixon's got. This takes great patience to be able to do this. So here we have something that probably Ezra had access to, and it's this statement here. This psalm is for the choir master, and it's to be done on stringed instruments. Here's one we prepared earlier. There's a stringed instrument, but that's probably not what that stringed instrument looked like. It probably looked like a thing called a lyre, which looks like a harp. And it's to be sung to that stringed instrument. So this is an instruction that Ezra has put in the notes to say, this is how David intended for this to be done. So I'm calling that verse zero. So verse one, what we see here is that King David, he knows God. This is not someone who's guessing. He knew God. He really knew God. He'd come to know who God is, and as a result, he developed great confidence in God's care for him. You remember, this is a 16-year-old boy that went out with a pocket of stones, a handful of stones, five smooth stones, it says, and a piece of leather thong, about that long, that had a pirate's patch thing in the leather thing, where he would wrap one end, just one little loop around his little finger, the other one right around his first finger, and he would go, Goliath, g'day, how we going? And Goliath laughs at him. Goliath mocks him. Goliath says, what am I, a dog? You're coming out with stones and sticks? What is this? What happens? What happens is David says, I'm not coming at you with stones. Anyone remember? I'm coming against you in the name of the Lord. And that thing, scholars estimate, that stone could be flung faster than a bullet could leave a gun. No wonder it embedded in Goliath's forehead near his temple, and he dropped down dead and died. Here's the point. It's moments like that that gave David great confidence that God was with him, that God could protect and deliver him. With that great confidence, we have Psalm 4, verse 1. It says, answer me. When I call, O God of my righteousness, you have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. So David's past experience with God, when he may have cried out with a prayer that says, oh God, if ever I needed your help, I need it now. And God delivered him. God came through. And we read in 1 Kings and we read in 1 and 2 Samuel of all of those times when David was in great distress and God came to his aid and delivered him. So he had great confidence that God would continue to be faithful to him. We read in verse 2, amen. How long shall my honour be turned into shame? Now this should, you should hopefully hear this and go, ah, there are people who are trying to undermine him. There are people who are slandering him. There are people who are saying all kinds of false things about him. How long will you love vain words, in other words, not true, and seek after lies? Then you've got this thing called Selah. Depends on how you say it. Selah. The point being is, I don't care how you say it. What we understand is that that's a musical notation that says, let the music just marinate a bit here. In other words, as you read this without music, just let it simmer a bit. think about this, just dwell on this thought, that in life, David, the one who was the man after God's own heart, he actually had people who were against him. He had people who were out to get him. I mean, how good do you have to be to not have anybody dislike you? I heard someone say Jesus was perfect and the world wanted to put him to death. So David knew that when anyone served God as a leader of God's people, there would be attacks. They might be physical or spiritual attacks that manifest physically. He also knew that if he just simply continued to serve God faithfully and not get distracted, as I think we've already heard this morning. Don't get distracted. Come to church on Sunday. Don't get distracted. Meet with God's people together. C.S. Lewis said, when the church meets together, they are coming into a community of different people in unity, and that's the closest thing you'll experience in this lifetime of God himself, Father, Son, and Spirit, different in perfect unity. You want to get to know God? One of the best places you can begin is right now, right here, in this holy place, made holy by the person on your left and your right. Not because there's anything special in the carpet, but because the people are here to worship God and to seek him. He also knew that as he continued to serve God faithfully, no matter what people said about him, which he's already said were lies and scandal, God would vindicate him. And he says it this way in the next verse, verse 3. But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. And he identifies himself as someone like that. The Lord hears when I call to him. How did he know that? Because God had heard him. He came to know that God heard. We can have that confidence too. And the trust bit comes in when we ask God, and there's many of us, I know, there's many of us here who are asking God for something that is outrageous. We're asking God to do something outrageous. And our response after we pray is trust. Be angry. Do not sin. Ponder in your own hearts, on your own beds, and be silent. Selah. You see, David is saying what these people were saying about him and doing against him to undermine him, it actually made him angry. Was that wrong of him? You see, anger, that is a response to injustice, is a good anger. There are men here who have an anger problem. Do not put your hand up if that's you. Because I'm going to tell you something. If you have an anger problem, you are getting angry at the wrong things, if that's your problem. But if you have an anger at injustice, especially the cause of others, the vulnerable, the weak, the defenseless, and that makes you angry, that is something that God has put into every man that they should be angry about. But if you're angry because you don't win, you don't get your way, people don't do what you want, shame on you, repent. There'll be a line here afterwards, you get behind me because I'll be the first one in that queue to repent. Be angry. Do not sin, David says. It's possible to be angry and not sin when it pertains to justice. So even in this moment that David's going through, and we get a glimpse of what he's feeling, what he's going through, he had to remind himself that in the times of distress, that he had to continue to keep trusting the Lord. He says this in verse 5 of Psalm 4, offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. And he's talking to his soul. And this is the thing that we need to know. David is talking to himself rather than listening to himself. Sometimes we listen to ourselves way too often. What we need to do is to talk to ourselves the things that are going to be good for our soul. And there are many who will say, It says in verse 6, who will show us some good? David's response, you want good? Lift up the light of your face, O God, upon us, O Lord. God, we're looking to you. We need you. We're in a situation that just doesn't look good. It's not great. We don't know what to do. So, Father, lift up your face and shine upon us, David is saying. This is David reminding himself. This is these R words, reflect, remind, remember. We all need to do that. It's not about dwelling in the past. It's about reflecting, reminding, and remembering the past so that we can face the future. I heard someone say they bought a car and the first thing they did was rip off the rear vision mirror. And I thought that was stupid. You do need to reflect, and especially look in your rear vision mirror, because that could prevent an accident, just by the way. And I think there's a principle in life there too. David says, you have put more joy in my heart than they when their grain and wine abound. And this grain and wine, this is a Hebrew expression that means good times. This is a great time. This is a time of celebration. And that's what that expression means. And David says, I don't need that. God has been so good to me. It's better than when the grain and the wine abound. And so what we see here is that a deepening knowledge of the Lord that leads us to constant remembering of God's goodness leads us and leads the worshipper to experience greater peace. And you will find this in the Psalms. You may want to take a red pen to it, or if you use your Bible app, highlight this in a bright color, because the Bible links experiencing God's peace with sleep. And there are some of you here, you put your head on a pillow at night and it's worry, 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 anxiety, anxiety, worry. But the one who puts their head on a pillow, having reflected, reminded and remembered who God is, his great goodness and his kindness and his faithfulness, is the one who can put their head on the pillow and sleep sweetly. And so we see in the closing verse, in peace, I will both lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. There's a security and a safety that comes from knowing God and trusting him. And if you've heard me say, oh good, I want God to do this, this and this for me, which could be new iPhone, new iPad, I'll talk over here, new whatever, then you haven't heard me at all. It's despite what he does or doesn't do, will you look to him and trust him and worship him? Because then in those moments, in peace, you will both lie down and sleep. Because you will know God alone, the Lord, is the one who causes you to dwell in safety. And so, as we will be considering the Psalms, as we go through this month, considering the Psalms, with a slight divergence when we come closer to Anzac Day, my prayer is that God may lead you, as you see on the screen there, to know him more deeply, more richly and more sweetly, and that you will increasingly experience his peace as you sleep. So, here's what I want you to know. This song that we're about to sing says this, I come to the altar. Are you hurting and broken within? Are you overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? You'll find reference to this in the Psalms. Here's the good news. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Would you please stand? Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He is risen. Bow down before him. He's Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. It sounds like a psalm. And I hope that as Sari comes in a moment to lead us in the benediction and closing prayer, that you will transact your worry and anxiety for his peace.
Let's sing. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Have you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Let's sing, oh, what a Savior.
And oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Sing that again. I want to.
And oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Bow down.
Bow down before him. For he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
As we've heard this morning, words paint beauty. Adam's first words was poetry. The prophets used poetry. Every psalm is a prayer. And every psalm expresses experiences. If I don't know what to pray, Psalms is my go-to book in the Bible. It covers every possible scenario I could be going through at the time. Anger, frustration, sadness, happiness, joy, just to mention a few. Where is your heart this morning? Are you far away from God? Do you want a personal relationship with God? Do you feel that you have drifted away? Please pray this very simple prayer with me. Dear Jesus, I believe in you and I want to have a relationship with you. I know I have sinned. Please forgive me and help me to live my life more like you. If you had said this prayer this morning and you don't have a Bible, please reach out to anyone in the church and we'll gladly give you one. We don't want you to try and navigate this journey alone, so reach out to someone who can help and guide you. And as we conclude this morning, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I pray that as we journey through the book of Psalms, that we will all grow closer and closer to God and know him more richly and deeply. Amen. Please join us for coffee and tea in the foyer.
Thank you so much for watching along with us today. Make sure to stay connected with us throughout the week by going online at legana.org or Facebook. We believe God has something unique to say to you, and our hope is that you feel his love stronger today than ever before. Thanks again for joining us, and have a great weekend.